What would you do if he walked into the room? What would you do if he walked into the room? What would you say if he walked into the room? How would you praise if he walked into the room? How would you shout if he walked into the room? How would you shout if he walked into the room? What would you do if he walked into the room? Yes, what would you do? Time of trouble.
king is in the room. Your healer's in the room. Your savior's in the room. Your provider's in the room. Your redeemer's in the room. Your champion's in the room. He's in this room. So what will you do? Jesus Christ, the King above all kings. Jesus Christ, the King above all kings.
Tana. Hey, every of you radical, come up to the front real quick. Come up to the front. 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 Come up to the front.
So sorry about that. Tonight is the Shield of Faith. I am super excited about the Shield of Faith. I can tell you that as we have went through this study, anybody else enjoyed it besides me? And it's not just me teaching. I love how much, even me teaching, I learn. But it is super exciting. This is just, tonight, the Shield of Faith, it's super fun. So, God wants us to know the importance of the Shield of Faith so much. And I want you to understand when we read this verse that Paul totally changes the wording on it. So somebody read to me what Ephesians 6 and 16 says.
Above all, taking the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one.
Okay, Paul has already told us, right, to put on the belt of truth and having the breastplate of righteousness and having the shoes of faith. But now Paul's telling us, above all, take up the shield of faith. Remember that we talked about the belt of truth. What's the two things that hang on the belt of truth? Remember 2 or 3 weeks ago we talked about the belt of truth? See if that's open for them to come in. It might be locked.
The sword?
It was the sword and the shield. That's the two main things that hung on the belt of truth. So you can't know the word of God unless you know the truth of God, correct? So faith serves as a double protector for the soldier because we already have the shield or the breastplate of righteousness, correct? So notice he says take up. The other ones say having. Now it says take up. So you have to take it up. It's not something. That means it's not something God's going to put on for you. It's something that you have to take up. It's believing that God is telling the truth in his word. It's not based on how you feel. Faith can't go off of feelings, right? We even talked about that because our feelings change. There are two types of shields that the Roman soldiers use. This lesson tonight is going to be a whole lot of history about the shield. Okay? So just prepare yourself. So, two types of shields that the Roman soldiers used. One was used for display and beauty. Have you seen, maybe you've watched some movies, but they're smaller, round, kind of the size of a pizza? You've seen those metal, those are used more in parades and in victories. Not really when they were going into battle. The second one was more for spiritual warfare. And this shield is what Paul is talking about. It's a much larger one. It was rectangle. It was 4 and a half feet high by 2.5 feet wide. It was more of a semi-circular shape to it. And the Roman called this shield, the scutum. S-C-U-T-U-M. The shield was built, okay, now we're going to go into more of how it was built. It was built with 2 layers of wood, similar to that of probably plywood. And as I read this, I had to understand that, you know, they didn't have all the tools that we have now. So just think of the timing that it took to create this, right? So it was built with 2 layers of strips of wood, and then they would heat that wood up, and they would form it into the shape, this semicircular shape that was 4 and a half foot high and 2.5 foot wide. And then they would cover it, y'all, with 6 layers of animal hide. So I wish I had like a display and I put pictures on there. I don't know if any of y'all besides me are more of a visual learner, but if I can see it, then I understand what I'm talking about. So that's why those pictures are on there, because hopefully I'm not the only one out here that is hands-on learning. But there was a handle inside so they could hold it up, obviously. The Greek name of this shield, and I absolutely love this, here's the Greek name of it, is Thureos. It's T-H-Y-R-E-O-S. T-H-Y-R-E-O-S. It's pronounced Thureos. It originates from the root word, are you ready? For thura. And that's T-H-U-R-A. Thura. You want to know what that word means? Door. It means door. So I got really excited about it whenever I read that that word means door. Because the shield of faith hides, or the shield hid the soldier. Pretty much, it was a door. Well, I get excited because on your handout, what does John 10 and 9 say?
I am the door.
Jesus is the door. I love that the Bible is line upon line, precept upon precept, and it totally goes right with everything it says, right? I absolutely love it. Love it, love it, love it. I am the door. So Here's where I get excited, because when the Roman soldiers were going into major conflict, they would form a line. Have you all ever watched old movies, whatever, and you've seen them form a line? So some of the armies would have over 500 men on their front line, that their shields were put together. So I did a little bit of math, and that means that that front line could be over a quarter of a mile wide, going into the enemy. So a line of men would advance with their shields in front of the troops behind them. And this shield was designed, are you ready? Here's your fill in the blank, to be linked with other soldiers. The shield was designed to be linked with other soldiers. No matter how many arrows, no matter how many spears there were that were thrown at the soldiers, it wouldn't wound them because of their wall, their door of protection that was in front of them. And then here's what they did. Once they got close, I wish I had a small door, even though I need a shield. But as they would get close, they would put their swords in between the slot. So when the enemy was there, I know it sounds gruesome, but when the enemy was there, they would just slide their sword back and forth and penetrate the enemy. Jesus even gave us this example in Matthew. Isn't that, and I think I put a picture on there of their lances maybe in between their shields. But in Matthew 4, do you remember when Jesus was in the desert and Satan came up and tried to tempt him? He said, you know, if you are the Son of God, then tell these stones to turn to bread. But what does Jesus do? Faith rises up and he uses the word of God against him, right? That, I mean, prime example of what we Christians are supposed to do. So first of all, he stops. He doesn't let the temptation take in his mind. No, he holds up that shield of faith and he speaks the word and stops the enemy right in where he is. See, when the soldier, or when the soldiers had got to a certain point in battle, they would embed their shields in the ground. Okay, and this provided, again, that huge wall of protection, but it allowed them to move. So picture this. As they were fighting, guess what this wall did? It advanced. It kept moving forward as they were able to knock down the enemy. Have any of you ever said, devil, that's mine. God's promised me this, I'm going after it. Or devil, you took this from me, I'm taking it back. What an awesome picture that is. Another thing is whenever they put that into the ground, they could hide behind it. And those lances that you saw there, they would hold them up over the top. So anytime the enemy tried to come at them, it landed right on that lance and they couldn't go through that wall, that door. Psalms 91. Oh my gosh, Psalms 91. Let me just say this was a rhema aha word for me during this study. Somebody read to me Psalms 91.
Whoever dwells in the secret... Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. Mm-hmm. He will cover you.
He will cover you.
With his feathers and under his wings, you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart.
Have any of y'all just read a verse and you've read it a lot, and then all of a sudden you're like, what does that mean? Yeah, I think we all have. Anybody have any idea what a rampart is? This is when I did the Shambok Shuffle in my study. I really wanted to throw my chair back and just get up and just do a little bit of shouting. Because rampart means protective barrier. His faithfulness will be your shield and your protective barrier. I want you to see that. That no matter what the enemy tries to come at you with, you have a protective barrier, amen, all around you. He can't go below it, he can't go over it, and he can't go around it. He can't go to the side of it because you have praise God, a protective, anybody else feel this besides me? You have a protective barrier around you. Jesus is your shield and your protective barrier. So just as the soldiers linked together, can I tell you, so must the body of Christ linked together. The Roman soldiers work together. See, by myself, I have less protection than I would if, Sherry, you were linking arms with me and we linked shields together. Right? Paul said that we are worked together. Paul even used the word one, speaking of the body of Christ. One body, right? The one Lord, one faith. We are supposed to be in unity of faith. For far too long, can I tell you that rigid religious beliefs have gotten in the way of us linking our shields together? I remember I had an individual that just, his belief was his way or the highway. And he straight up pointed his finger at me and said, "You are going to go to hell." And I was like, "No, thanks, but no, I'm not." Because I didn't believe the way he did. Straight up pointed his finger at me and said, "You're going to hell." No, just because I don't believe the way you do does not mean I'm going to hell. Right? For far too long, politics have gotten in the way. And I'm not even going to go there. But I'm telling you, for far too long, if you don't vote the way I do, I can't talk to you. If God saved you, I'm supposed to love you. If God has saved you, I'm supposed to care for you. It doesn't, I don't care about that. What I care about is your soul. Amen? See, we've allowed money and pride to get in the way of us linking our shields together. Isn't it amazing when you see it in the spirit? And when the enemy has really tried to come in and disrupt and cause discord, okay? There's things that just because I believe, I can't get you to believe it if you can't see it. But you know who can? If it's in the Word of God and the Word is true of what I'm trying to tell you, but you're not listening, then only the Holy Spirit can take the blinders off your eyes so you can see it. It doesn't matter how much I go down your throat with it. It's not going to work until your heart is open to receive it. Matthew, we can find the power of working together in Matthew 18 and 9. What does it say?
"Again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth about anything that they may ask, it shall be done for them by my Father who is in heaven."
See, sometimes I need somebody to... Anybody ever had a battle where you knew that you couldn't do it on your own, that you had to ask one of your brother or sister, say, "Hey, I need you to pray with me. This is bigger than just me trying to overcome." Right? Just like Aaron and her. Read Exodus 17 and 12. I love this picture right here. When Moses got weak, what happened?
"When Moses' arms grew tired, Aaron and Hur brought a stone for him to sit on, while they stood beside him and held up his arms, holding them steady until the sun went down."
Somebody might need to stand with you when you need healing. Whenever I got a bad report from the doctor, let me just tell you, when they called me over the weekend and I had to go a whole long time saying, "Stephanie, I'm sorry, your blood work looks really bad. I'm just going to tell you it looks bad. I need to send you to an oncologist." Well, oncologist, hello, bells and whistles. Okay, what's going on? What's cancer? Why are you sending me there? So they thought I had leukemia because of the way my blood work was. But do you know what kind of mind games there was in the waiting time? It was very hard, and it was times where I didn't want to turn my waiting room into a worship room. I just wanted to cry, and God, what is going on? But I needed somebody to link shields with me and encourage me and speak the word of God over me. I need somebody to stand with us. Maybe when your marriage is rocky, believe that this isn't the final end. Believe that this isn't the outcome, that God did put us together, right? When maybe we've lost a loved one and depression has stood in and we don't understand the plans of God, link shield, amen, and get them through it. When we have a wayward child, link shield and pray and believe that God is going to bring them back. God. Maybe I just need to stay in this room. I like this room a lot better than the sanctuary. My goodness. It takes the whole body of Christ working together in unity. Because you know what? I got this visual whenever I was studying. Sometimes the hand is trying to do this to the face. And sometimes the left foot is tripping over the right foot because they don't agree. No. It's you need to be able to speak in tongues. No, you need to baptize this way. No, you need to... Do you understand what I'm saying? And we're tripping over each other when really we have a whole world that's dying that we're supposed to save. And we're fighting over the small things. Walk in unity. Another way that the soldiers used their shield was when they went to take over a city. When they were marching into the city walls, they would do their shields like we talked about earlier. They would link them up and arrange them in a box. But then they also held the shield over their heads, which formed a shell. And it was called the testudo, T-E-S-T-U-D-O. We're in big trouble, y'all. I've got 16 pages, and I'm only on page 6. Wait, this might be a part 2. Is that one of your fill-in-the-blanks? It is, right? Yeah, I thought so. Okay, it formed a shell, and it was called testudo, T-E-S-T-U-D-O. So what happens whenever you're marching in to take over a city? We've all seen it. There's soldiers on the walls, and what are they doing? They're shooting at you. But with this, guess what? You might be able to feel it, but you keep walking into the enemy territory, right? That's the power of linking together again. It doesn't matter. You're able to go into the city and tear down those strongholds. You're able to, how many prayer meetings? That's what it's for. We just talked about. It's just to speak revival into this city. Speak revival into East Texas. Look, linking together. I have a hard time sitting down tonight. I'm super excited about this lesson. Linking together. And then, you know what I thought about is, how many of you ever played the Red Rover game? I don't even know if they still do that game or not. Do you remember that in elementary? Red Rover, Red Rovers, and Jamie Rightover, right? But you remember the power of linking your hands and your arms together and they couldn't get through? That's exactly the visual. I know it sounds kind of petty, but that is a very good visual. When we are linked together, the enemy cannot get through, right? And we have to stay together in the last days, because it even says in the last days that men will turn away from their faith. How do we take care of our shields? We talked earlier about the shields being made up of wood and the 6 layers of animal hide. But they had to maintain their shields, because what happens to animal hide if you don't take care of it? It becomes brittle and it breaks, right? So they had to take very good care of it, because the shield underwent a lot of heat, right? The fiery darts. So what we just read? So, and the Roman soldier, there was 3 types of arrows that were in battle. There was the normal arrow, of course, that we all have seen, that we still use today in hunting. But then they had tar-dipped arrows that they would ignite before they launched them. And then they had the fiery explosive arrow, which had combustible material on it, and when it hit, it would explode, and fire would go everywhere. So you had the normal plain arrow, you had the tar-dipped arrow, and you had the fiery explosive arrow. The perfect, am I going too fast? Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Thanks, Renee. Thanks for your honesty. She said, uh-huh. Okay. So you had the normal arrow, the tar-dipped arrow, and the fiery explosive arrow. The purpose of the fire was to ignite the shield. Okay? The arrow would stick to the shield, and it would burn while it was in battle. So guess what happened to the soldier? He became distracted because the shield was on fire. The shield had got hit. So the fiery arrows would distract the soldier, and can I tell you what it does to us? It distracts our faith, right? That's the visual that he was trying to put out there. He would be more concerned about his shield being able to last through battle, and he's trying to pull it out, that he's become distracted about the other things going on around him. So the normal arrows is that which is common to all men. What does it in 1 Corinthians 10 and 13 say?
No temptation has overtaken
you. Thanks for reading all of these. Appreciate it.
No temptation is overtaking you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it.
Okay. But that what is common to mankind. So how many of us, no matter how long we've been saved or how little we've been saved, there are these little temptations that we all get tripped on, right? Worry, fear, discouragement. Yes, all of us can say, yes, those are the normal arrows. Now, your arrows that we talked about that were dipped in tar represents the unclean things that are kind of like tar, that when we get into them, they're kind of hard to get rid of. OK, Okay? 2 Corinthians 10 and 17. Or 10 and 5, I'm sorry. 2 Corinthians 10 and 5. What does it say?
We break down every thought and proud thing that puts itself up against the wisdom of God. We take hold of every thought and make it obey Christ.
Okay. What do we have to do? We have to do something, right? We have to break it down. We have to take hold. The third arrow is the fiery explosive arrow. It's the most dangerous because when it hits, it spreads and it explodes. It's those bad situations that we've allowed ourselves to get into, where all of a sudden you realize, how did I get here? This is not me. What has happened? It's the addiction. It's the betrayal. It's the inappropriate action maybe that you took. It's the homosexual relationship that you're like, this is how, yeah. Satan gets in real quick, don't he? Give him an inch and he'll take a mile. Paul tells us that we are to quench the fiery darts of the enemy. Fiery darts are easy to quench when they just hit your shield. But you know what happens when you allow them to stay in there? They're harder to get off. When you leave them there, they're burning your faith. That's what I want you to understand. It's more difficult to quench when you let it sit there and burn up your faith. We have to remember this enemy's plan is to steal, kill, and destroy. Every Roman soldier, this is beautiful to me. Every Roman soldier carried something that I did not realize. Do you know what they carried? They carried a bottle of oil. Amen. Right? And they would rub oil on their shield. Every morning they would dip it in water and then they would rub oil on it. This would prevent the shield from cracking. This would prevent it from burning when the fiery darts hit it. This would keep it from the tar from sticking to the shield. Any of y'all about to just do a Holy Ghost dance right now besides me? My goodness, my goodness. The oil came from, guess what? The olive trees. Olive trees. Do you know what the olive tree is symbolic of? It's the anointing of the Holy Spirit. The process of the olives were beaten and crushed, and it produced the olive oil that contains the spiritual significance of well. You know what that spiritual significance is? It symbolizes Jesus Christ was beaten, and he was crucified to the cross, and that he sent the Holy Spirit to be poured out upon his church while he is in heaven. Isn't it beautiful? In essence, Jesus Christ is the olive tree, and the Holy Spirit is the olive oil. So you cannot afford to go a really long season without the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Isaiah 21 and 5, what does it say?
Get up, you officers. Oil the shield.
Get up, you officers. Why does it say that? Sometimes we don't feel like getting up. That's doing. Get up, you officers, and you better oil your shields. David said, I will praise the Lord. Even when he didn't feel like it, I will. I'm going to make the effort. I will anoint my shield with oil. I will get into the presence of God. How do we anoint our shield? Jude 1 and 20 tells us, what does it say?
But you, beloved, building up yourself in the most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit.
We anoint our shield by praying. How else do we do it? Romans 10 and 17, what does it say?
So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God.
So we speak the word of God and we anoint our shields. When we pray and we speak the word of God, we anoint our shields. It's not just the shoes. It's not shoes that quench the fiery darts, is it? It's not the helmet. It is the shield of faith. It is the only piece of the armor that can quench the fiery darts. See, the very first time, here is absolutely an amazing thing. And maybe you already know this. But do you know the very first time we hear about a shield is when God is speaking to Abraham? Did I skip something, y'all? Everybody got anything? I didn't skip it? Okay. Do you know where we hear about shield at the very first time? It's in Genesis 15 and 1. What does it say?
After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward.
Okay, I want you to go home and I want you to read what has happened before this. Because what has happened is Abram brought in his tithe to Melchizedek. Hello, he just tithed. And then here comes God saying to him, here's the word of the Lord. I am your shield and I am your exceeding great rewarder. God, and you know what he does though? I want you to go in and I want you to read it. Because it says Abraham turns around and he's like, remember when you told me you were going to give me a son? That's been like, 10 years, God. but he said, God, you said that you will number, right?
No.
Like the dust of the earth. And you shall become a father of many nations. Well, 10 years have passed. He reminds God of his promise. And then what does God tell him? Look at verse 5 and 6. I put it on there.
Then the Lord brought him outside and said, look now toward heaven and count the stars if you are able to number them. And he said to him, so shall your descendants be. And he believed in the
Lord.
Wait,
what did he do? Say it again.
Number
6.
Oh, and he believed in the Lord.
Ah.
And he accounted it to him for righteousness.
Did Abraham see the son? No, he didn't. He didn't at all. But he believed what God said was true and he walked in faith. It's amazing that the first fear not also is right here after tithing. Because how many of us, let's be honest, how many of us it was time to write a tithe check and you're like, gosh, I could really use that to pay bill. Uh-huh. Yeah. But here he is. Fear not, Abraham. Why? The fiery darts of the enemy. Here, because he said in Malachi, and I didn't even put that on there, but in Malachi it says, bring your full tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this. Right? Test me in this and see if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing without measure. Test me in this. Test me in this and see if I will not be your shield and if I will not be your rewarder and if I will not open the window of heaven. Fear not, nothing shall touch you unless I permit it. Isaiah 54 and 17, and you know what I did? I put this verse on our kids, on our refrigerator, so that way every time the kids get up and they have to make their lunch or they have to eat breakfast, they see this before they go to school. Isaiah 54, did I put it on there? I didn't? Oh, sorry. Well, write it down. Here it is. Isaiah 54 and 17, nothing shall by any means harm you, for God is with you. Nothing shall by any means harm you, for God is with you. No weapon. Habakkuk 2 and 4. Habakkuk 2 and 4 says, the righteous live by what? Faith. The righteous live by faith. To have faith means that faith has to become a regular way of thinking, a regular way of doing, and a regular way of being. It means that you have to take an entire different perspective on the situation that you have in your life. Abraham didn't have a son yet. It'd been 10 years. But what's it say? It said that he believed. See, you choose to view your situation through through a lens of faith or through the physical. You do. You choose. And how many of us, the views don't quite line up? Faith and physical don't just quite line up, does it? But that's the nature of faith. Because Hebrews 11 and 1 says, what? Now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. See, a lot of people just hope and they stop there. Yes? And that won't work. Can I tell you, I didn't ask my husband, but I'm just gonna tell you what he did. Sorry.
Oh, no.
So we own a business, okay? And when you get into business, you're really hoping that it works. Sometimes. You're really hoping that it works. But can I tell you that what he did in his walk, he learned to change his perspective. He learned to change his way of thinking. Because on his visor in his truck, he's got a prayer that he's typed out. And it says, Lord, I thank you that you're bringing people into my life that will want to help me, that will make me prosper in this industry. I thank you that you have given me favor with man as I go in to bid this job, as I go in to talk with this builder. I thank you that you are giving me wisdom beyond my own understanding, that you're giving me knowledge, that you're giving me favor. Take the blinders off and realize that you can walk in this. Take the lens of your physical off and realize that you can walk in faith. Amen? Sorry, babe. Told on you.
Well, that's better than I was expecting. Better than I was expecting.
It wasn't anything bad. It was good, I promise. But really, how many of us get stuck with this is where I am and this is how life is going to be? It doesn't have to be that way. I love that it said, I thank you that you're going to bring people into my life that will help me, that will take me to the next level. Faith is the substance or the confidence of things hoped for. If I say, well, I hope God heard my prayer, well, that's not good enough. Hope says I have it sometimes, but you know what faith says? Faith says I have it now. Real faith in God's word. See, let me just tell you a little story. So there was a community of farmers that was in a drought. And it was becoming very, very bad. And the preacher in that community decided, you know what, let's call a prayer meeting. So they called a prayer meeting, and there was people, that tons of people that showed up for this prayer meeting. And the pastor said as he walked to the front to start the prayer meeting that he noticed there was an 11-year-old girl sitting in the front pew. And it caught his eye because in the very front, the girl had an umbrella that was open. Nobody else in the congregation showed up with an umbrella except the 11-year-old girl. He said, at that moment, I realized that this little girl's innocent, that it made him smile because of the faith that she possessed, that no one else in the congregation had brought this umbrella except for her. All came to pray for rain, but this little girl came expecting God to answer. Isn't that an awesome story that he told? And then, of course, the rain came. Right? There are five levels of faith spoken in scriptures. And this is your next fill in the blank. I think we're going to finish, y'all. Okay. Five levels of faith. There's faith. There's no faith that's talked about in Mark 4 and 40. And there is little faith in Matthew 8 and 26. There is weak faith in Romans 4 and 19. There is strong faith in Romans 4 and 20. And there is great faith in Matthew 8 and 10. In Matthew 8 and 10, this is when the centurion came up to Jesus and he said, Jesus, my servant is at the house and he's paralyzed. And Jesus is like, okay, I'll go and pray for him. And he's like, no, just speak the word. And Jesus said, I have not seen great faith like this. Right? So many times we read in the Bible where Jesus says, your faith has made you whole, right? We can go in and we can read the Gospels. We can remember the woman with the issue of blood, and he said, who touched me? He said, your faith has made you whole, right? The lepers, the 10 lepers, and there was one that came back and worshiped Jesus at his feet. And he said, rise and go your way. Your faith has made you whole. Luke 5 and 17, where he heals the paralyzed man as his friends drop him through the roof. And you know what it says there? It says that he saw their faith. I don't know if you realize this or not, but they got to the front door and they couldn't get in because the house was full of so many people. So the way that the houses were, because they took baths on the roofs, right? So they had to carry the man up the stairs of a house that they didn't know, keep in mind. Okay? And then when they get up there, they're like, what are we going to do? Well, they got to dig a hole through somebody's roof, y'all, that they don't even know, first of all. And it's not going to be a small hole. It's going to be a big hole that they got to drop this man down in front of Jesus. And it says, and when he saw their faith, your sin is forgiven. Rise up your bed and walk, right? I love that. And Jesus heals the blind man in Luke 18, and he tells him, your faith has made you whole. If you want to read some faith stories to get your faith built up because you're going through a trial, go and read Hebrews 11, because it says, now my faith, it's not just about healing. Okay, faith isn't just about healing. I know that what I just gave you was. But it says, now by faith, Abel offered a more excellent sacrifice. Now by faith, Enoch was taken away. Now by faith, Noah prepared an ark, right? Now by faith, Abraham obeyed and went, not knowing where he was going. Now by faith, Sarah bore a child. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau. I want you to see what verse chapter 11 and 23 says. I didn't put it on there, but just remember to go back and read it, okay? Because it says, by faith, 11 and 23, by faith, Moses, when he was 12 months old, was hidden by his parents. Then the very next thing says, by faith, Moses, when he was their age, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Can I just tell you that Moses couldn't have had faith when he was only 3 months old? So the story of faith for Moses begins with the faith of his parents. I never saw that. I'm just going to be straight up honest with you. I never saw that. Because it says, by faith Moses. But it's talking about his parents in that verse. So, see, what that tells me is that Moses could look over his life and see the faithfulness of God. He could say, okay, God, you kept me in the basket in the river. If you can keep me in the basket in the river, then you can keep me now when I have to lead these children out of Egypt, right? By faith, he can lead the children out of Egypt. By faith, he can keep the covenant of the Passover and the firstborn would not be killed. By faith, he was able to cross the Red Sea. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell. By faith, the three Hebrew boys in the fiery furnace, it took some faith not to bow, especially whenever they opened the door and the soldiers burned because the fire is so hot. You wonder if there was just a question. Maybe you should bow and worship the king. Yeah? My favorite one, though, is Job. Because by faith, Job said, even though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. Imagine. I know y'all are sitting here just think, yuck, faith. But I want you to imagine losing your children. Losing everything you have.
Your wife turned against you.
And then you have to say, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. What kind of faith is that? See, there's something very important that we all can learn from this chapter in Hebrews. Is the same faith that enables some people to escape from trouble, it enables others to endure it. The same faith that delivers some from death enables some to die victoriously. And I never really understood that until my husband's brother, younger brother, died of cancer. And he looked at Matt and he told him these words, cancer is what saved my life. And we're like, what? And he said, I knew that cancer is what it would take for me to totally turn my back to the world and focus on Jesus. And if cancer is what it took to get me to heaven, then so be it. Faith allows some to be delivered from death, but then it enables some to be victorious in death. Faith is not a bridge over troubled waters. I didn't write that down on your paper, but faith is not a bridge over troubled waters. It is a pathway through them. Faith is a stretching process. You grow when you're on the other side of your trial. Hebrews 12:2 tells us that we are supposed to be looking unto Jesus, who is what? The author and the finisher of our faith. And it says, above all else, we need to take up what? The shield of faith. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for what you're doing. We thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you for the shield of faith and the protective barrier that you've given us. We thank you that you are the door in our life. Father, we thank you that we can run to you, Father, for protection. For encouragement, Father, whatever we need, we can find it in you. Father, we give you praise, we give you glory and honor. And Father, I pray that you would protect us as we go through this week. Father, I pray that the anointing of God would just move upon people. And Father, as they pass by this facility, that something would draw them in to this place. Father, we give you glory, we give you honor. In Jesus' name, amen.